Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer has given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled." All of them deserted him and fled. The word of God for the people of God.
Well, I feel like I'm kind of stuck on old Western films. Last week I started with this introduction out of the old Western one, which is one of my favorites, Big Country. And then this week I chose for the sermon title a 1966 Western film which stars Clint Eastwood, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, which, by the way, is not a favorite of mine. Matter of fact, I'm not sure I've ever watched that film, to be honest about it. But I know enough about it to know that the three main characters in the film, Clint Eastwood and his two co-stars, are the good, the bad, and the ugly. I've often wondered what it's like to be cast the character, the ugly, but anyway. But I'm really not interested in the film, but I am interested in the title. I'm interested in that theme. I'm interested in that movement that goes from good to bad to ugly. Because there's a progression there that fits so neatly and proclaims so well the movement of our worship and our lives today. Because it starts off good. It starts off maybe even great. The scripture titles usually in your Bibles, right before you get to the Palm Sunday story, say the triumphant entry. It's like this is the peak. This is the highest it gets for Jesus and Jesus' ministry. As he makes his way into the large metropolitan area of Jerusalem, this great walled city, he is met by crowds of people. Dozens, hundreds probably, thousands maybe, who gather along the road that Jesus rides in, and they throw a parade. It's the best word for it. It's really the only description. As I shared with the children, it's not like our parades, but it was their parade. They wave the palm branches in the air. They sing the choruses they knew. They chanted and cheered and clapped and called. And Jesus rode through the midst on this high moment in his life and in his ministry, celebrating the peak of popularity. And the people were so thrilled because they knew what was coming next, or thought they did, because he entered as the triumphant leader of their people. And he was going to set everything right. But it's not all good, is it? It doesn't all stay good anyway. Because even as Jesus is riding into Jerusalem, there are those who are not excited about his coming. There are those who do not celebrate his entry. There are those who are already raising the flag of caution, saying, "You're going to cause all of us a great, great deal of trouble." Jesus had for a long time now lived in opposition to the religious leaders of his day. Jesus was not popular among the priests. He was not popular among the Pharisees. For the most part, he was not popular among the Sadducees. He was not popular among the religious leaders of his day. Many times because he didn't follow all the rules, and they were rule people, and rule breakers are not popular. He told a truth in a way that was so disturbing. Because he told it with such authority. And he challenged them over and over again. And so, as he comes into Jerusalem this week and begins to teach the people who gather in great crowds in the temple, they try to undermine his ministry. We know the stories. They try to trick him with this question or that question. They have people there. They're trying to humiliate him. They try to get him in trouble with Rome. They try to do all kinds of things to undermine his ministry and just make him less popular. Just make him look like a fool. Just make him do something stupid. And then the people will forget about him and all this will go away and life will go back to the way it was. And it's not great, but it's okay. We can all live that way. But that doesn't work, does it? Jesus isn't humiliated. He doesn't make a fool of himself. He makes a fool of them over and over again. And so, good goes to bad, which goes to worse, which finally becomes really quite ugly. The religious leaders of Jesus' day, the priest, the high priest, the royal council began to gather behind closed doors in small rooms and in tight numbers and say to each other, we'd all be better off if he were dead. The religious leaders are plotting murder. The religious leaders are plotting murder. It's like our council of bishops getting together and hiring a hitman to knock somebody off. It's like that. And they don't just want to kill him. I mean, you could assassinate him to kill him, but they really want him tortured to death. Using one of the most cruel means of execution that was ever known in all time. To take a human being and just nail him to a cross and let him hang there in absolute total agony until he dies, which can take days. They wanted to make an example. They wanted him tortured to death. And why? Why? To save their own tiny, petty thrones of power and authority. To maintain the status quo. That's what we like to think, because that's the easy answer, and that's the answer that says, I would never do that. But there's more to stake here than that. If a religious rebellion breaks out in Jerusalem, what's Rome going to do? Rome's going to get rid of religion as best they can in Jerusalem. And who's going to die? Lots of people. But Rome's also pretty good about making examples. The high priest will die, probably on a cross. But not just him, all of that council. But not just them, all of their spouses. But not just them, all of their children. It's not just about who gets to wear the high priest's crown. There's a lot more at stake here than that. These men, and they're all men, are protecting their homes and their families, their spouses, and their children. Now, if you have to choose between some backwood itinerant preacher who's thrown together a couple of neat magic tricks and protecting your spouse and your family from torture and death, what are you going to choose? And suddenly, good and bad get all mixed up. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, it is so easy to look back at people who do horrible things and say they're horrible people, and I'm not. And therefore, I would never do that. But Lord, it's something else to look at what's at stake in all of our lives and to realize the call upon your heart, our hearts, by you, and the pledge of faith we offer and give. Help us, Lord, to realize today that in any given circumstance, most of us, maybe all of us, God, are capable of not only good, but also bad. And maybe sometimes, God, under the right circumstances, even ugly. Forgive us, God. Grant us your grace in this and every moment. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hosanna, Hosanna, O blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, O blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Special Sunday this Sunday. All of you, most of you, I think, helped by carrying in one of these. Why do we carry these in? Does anybody know? What's this all about? Yes. It is Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday is always the Sunday before what next? What comes next week? Easter. That's absolutely right. Several of you had that answer. That was wonderful. We bring in palms. But what's the story about? We sang about the story. Do you know what happened? The reason we use palms on Palm Sunday? What happened? Yes.
The other people
used palms. You're absolutely right about that. A long, long time ago, when Jesus was living and lived among us, although not in this country, in a country a long way from here, but he lived, and he came into a big city one day called Jerusalem, and they kind of had like a parade. But they didn't have marching bands, and they didn't have pom-pom twirlers, and they didn't have fire engines and stuff like that. What they did have was the palm branches off of the trees. And so they took them down, and they waved them around in the air, and they sang songs to celebrate Jesus' coming to the city. And so on Palm Sunday, we kind of do the same thing. It's kind of like at Christmas when we do a nativity and we remember how Jesus was born. On Palm Sunday, we always act out the palms. And we become like they were. We become a little parade, and we bring in our palms and we wave them and we sing a song to celebrate Jesus and Jesus' life and Jesus' love for each of us. Now, I know when you came here, they had you drop off the palms up here and they spread them around up front. But if you would like to take a palm with you, you can have one. Do you want a palm to take home? Do you want one? Go ahead. We'll pass them around, okay? And there's one. There's a couple down here. There's one. Did everybody get one? Did you not get one? Here. I hope we have enough. That'll be bad, won't it? Here we go. Does anybody want a palm? Now, don't smack each other with them, okay? All right, and when you get back to your seat, now there's some more over there. Yeah, Mason, if you could help me out here a little bit. And just hand those out to the other children that would like to have them, okay? All right. And when you get back to your seat, you can give them to Mom and Dad, okay? And then after that, later on, you can take them home with you, okay? Let's bow our heads real quickly for a word of prayer. Let's pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you for not only coming into the city, but coming into our hearts. Bless these children that you may live in their hearts. Help us, Lord, to celebrate your presence in our lives like a parade. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming up here.